The next item of business is a statement by George Adam on Scottish Government response to the report of the Citizens' Assembly of Scotland. The Minister will take questions at the end of his statement, so there should be no interventions or interruptions. And I call on the Minister for around 10 minutes, please.
Presiding Officer, and thank you, Presiding Officer. Today I am pleased to publish the Scottish Government response to Doing Politics Differently, the report of the Citizens' Assembly of Scotland. This is a crucial step for both the Citizens' Assembly of Scotland and any plans for public participation in our democracy in the future. There will be no value if Government and this Parliament do not demonstrate that we have heard and acted on the views and expressed by the people of Scotland through these processes. Before I speak about our response, I want to acknowledge once again the commitment, enthusiasm and energy that the members of the Citizens' Assembly brought to their task. Their dedication can be clearly seen in the breadth and ambition of their ambition and recommendations, and I thank them all of the members of the Assembly and many of the people who supported their work. The Assembly worked through a unique period of time, beginning its work in October 2019 with a series of face-to-face events and finally completing its work online in December 2020. The willingness of members to stick with the Assembly through the challenges of the pandemic, adapt to virtual working and to bring their experience of lockdown to the table makes the vision and recommendations all the more important as we continue to live with restrictions and we plan to build back better. The Assembly produced 10 vision statements and 60 wide-ranging recommendations directed to the Scottish Government and to this Parliament. Some of these recommendations call for detailed policy responses, while others address more fundamental questions around how decisions are taken and how politicians and government can be scrutinised and held to account. The vision of the Citizens' Assembly is long-term. To realise the scope of its ambition, we will require change beyond the term of this Parliament alone. While our response lays out our immediate commitments, we also acknowledge the scale of the challenge the Assembly has set us all. When the report of the Citizens' Assembly was debated in Parliament in February, the Cabinet Secretary for Constitution, Europe and External Affairs explained that there was not enough time before the election to give the report and its ambitious recommendations the full and detailed consideration that they deserve. Since then, the recommendations have informed party manifestos. The agreement between Government and the Scottish Green Party and the Programme for Government and also the COVID recovery strategy and other important areas of policy. When we published a consultation on Scotland's first framework for tax in August, the consultation document set out the vision for tax put forward by the Citizens' Assembly for Scotland. The consultation response to specific recommendations from the Assembly included to provide more information in accessible language about taxes. Building on the manifesto commitments and with the agreement of the Scottish Green Party, the Programme for Government sets out the Government's commitment to participative democracy, including the Citizens' Assembly model. This is a long-term commitment, and to build on the real successes of this Citizens' Assembly and the Climate Assembly that reported to this Parliament in June, to transform the way that the people are involved in decision-making in Scotland. Our ambition, echoing the ambitions of the Assembly's recommendations, is for public participation processes in Scotland to be a permanent addition to the democratic process in Scotland. We have gathered together a group of experts and participants, easy for me to say, Presiding Officer, Democracy for Scotland from the UK and around the world. This group is considered the real and practical actions we need to take and to deliver our commitments. For example, how to set the questions to be answered by a Citizens' Assembly. The group's work has been informed by research into the experience of Citizens' Assembly of Scotland, so we can capture and benefit from all the important development work and learning from the Assembly. The expert working group is due to report in the next few weeks with recommendations on how to fulfil our commitments on future participation. Not just citizens' assemblies, but other forms of participation, including at a local level. Our plans of deliberative engagement on sources of local government funding already include plans for participative work on both local and national level. Deliberative engagement can start locally and culminate in the national Citizens' Assembly. Our other specific commitment is a brand new citizen assembly for under-16s. This will ensure that the generation that will grow up with the consequences of the decisions we take now can be involved in making them. It also echoes the Assembly's concern with the issues that face young people today. As well as their recommendations on entrenching participation in our system, the Assembly raised some fundamental questions about the scope and structure of the democratic engagement in Scotland's formal governmental and parliamentary institutions. Not all of them make for comfortable reading for us in this Parliament or indeed in government. Specific recommendations include the conduct and integrity of politicians, the responsibility of MSPs to their constituents, and the availability of accessibility and comprehensive information. Given recent events in the Westminster Parliament, the importance of integrity in our political representatives can hardly be overstated. These challenges should be of concern to everyone in this Parliament and in government. We will be working with Parliament and seek cross-party involvement to address these challenges. A further immediate impact of the Assembly on engagement and participation in government was the experience of the plans to recover from the pandemic. The Assembly reports reflects members' experience of the spring of 2020. In our response, we set out the importance of public engagement to developing the COVID recovery strategy. This strategy highlights the work of the Assembly in reflecting the concerns of members who themselves are representatives of the wider public as they consider the issues arising from COVID even as they were unfolding. In my statement today, I have highlighted the recommendations of the Assembly on participation and the Government's plans to progress these. In many ways, these are the heart of the Assembly's report, and its work is the evidence of the potential importance of greater systematic engagement with a public, with representative selection of the people of Scotland. But the response we are publishing today goes much further than that and wider than these recommendations. It sets out how the Government is acting in a range of specific policy areas identified by the Assembly, building on the commitments made in our election manifesto earlier this year, as now set in the programme for government and the COVID recovery strategy and elsewhere. Not all of our plans are identical to the recommendations, but the themes identified by the Assembly and many of the detailed recommendations are reflected in the government's priority for this Parliament. Some of the recommendations are beyond the current powers of the Scottish Parliament and the Government itself, and the Assembly has made some specific proposals for additional responsibilities to allow us to fulfil their vision. However, as I said earlier, this response can only be the start of a long-term vision set out by the Assembly for the transformative change for Scottish politics, which will go beyond the programme for government and indeed this Parliament. Embedding deliberative democracy in our decision-making process, ensuring trust and transparency in our institutions, hearing the voices of the people of Scotland and demonstrating that we are acting on their views are all very important in this process. There are challenges, and these are the challenges and the legacies of the Citizens' Assembly of Scotland to us all here today. I am optimistic that all of us in this Parliament can share something of that vision for a stronger, more inclusive democracy that shines through the report of the Citizens' Assembly. I hope that we can work together to ensure that we act on the recommendations of the Citizens' Assembly of Scotland that aspire to fulfil that ambition and vision, and that we look, in the words of the Assembly, to do politics differently.
Thank you, Minister. The Minister will now take part in a participatory Q&A session on issues raised in his statement. I tend to allow around 20 minutes for that. I would invite members who wish to participate to press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible. And I call on Miles Briggs.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer, and can I thank the Minister for advance of his statement, and also take this opportunity to thank the Assembly members for the power of work which they've put into the Assembly and this report. A key theme running throughout the report, though, is a recommendation, and the recommendations, is that people want to see decisions taken as close to local communities and people as possible. Now, there seems to be a disconnect, though, within the Scottish Government around this and how we do politics differently. COSLA, for example, have called Scottish Government plans for a national care service an attack on localism, and this potentially being an end for anything other than central control of services in Scotland. So can I ask the Minister, how does he match that with his statement he's just given today?
Minister.
I thank the member for that question. What I will say is the fact that we have taken on board absolutely everything that was put forward by the Citizens' Assembly of Scotland. And of that, I mentioned in my speech, was the fact that there would be need for decision-making made at a local level. But one of the most important things that we have to see is, as we go through this process, is what we deliver the services that the people of Scotland want and that the representatives of the Assembly do as well. And I believe that if we continue down this route, and just to make the members put the members' mind at ease, we find a way to trying to work with locally and on a national level, we can solve many of the issues that the member has brought up.
Neil Bibby.
I thank the Minister for advance sight of his statement. I commend the work of the Citizens' Assembly and the many progressive ideas they put forward for creating a fairer and more equal Scotland. They are important proposals that deserve to be acted upon. What would the Minister regard as the biggest change in government policy in response to the report? Can the Minister also confirm that this will be an annual report going forward and statement to ensure we can measure progress on this work and that it does not go to waste? For example, the report calls for capping on private sector rents. When will the Government deliver on this? How also will the Government use its existing powers, procurement powers, to extend the living wage? Finally, one of the report's other recommendations was to increase accountability of those elected. Would the Minister therefore agree that if we are serious about doing politics differently and better, then MSPs should be banned from having paid directorships? And going further, with only fair and reasonable exemptions, that MSPs should be prohibited from having any second job?
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. There were numerous questions there. I'll try and answer as many of them as I possibly can. But one of the things that I would say about doing things differently for ourselves, and if you ask the main question you asked right at the very beginning, Mr. Bibby, was the fact that what is the main difference? I would say the main difference would be the agreement between ourselves and the Scottish Green Party, between the Scottish Government and the Scottish Green Party, because what they came across and comes across all the time when we're dealing with members of the public is the fact that they want the political parties to work together in order to create the greater good for everyone else in our society. So on the whole, I would say that's probably the best example of it. With regards to very many of the other issues, as we move forward, we obviously need to make sure that all the members of the organisation and the Citizens' Assembly are listened to and their ideas are included. And I think I made it perfectly clear with in my own actual statement that we are willing to do that and the differences that they have made throughout government. It's not just a case, Mr. Bibby, of how it's changed maybe a specific policy or has it created a different bill. It's found a different way for government to actually make sure that we can deliver what the public have asked us to do. And that may be through various other processes and other bills as well. And on the whole, with regards to Mr. Bibby's idea, that was one of the issues that came up, was that how politicians act and how politicians engage with the world and what they do is one of the uncomfortable things of the whole debate that the Citizens' Assembly of Scotland had, and it's one that we should all take very seriously as we have debates and we move forward in the future.
Michelle Thompson, to be followed by Donald Cameron.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and can I add my voice of thanks to those who participated in the Citizens' Assembly. I'd be interested to hear how the Scottish Government plans to feedback ongoing progress to them after all their hard work. I note with interest that 62% of participants strongly agreed that the Scottish Parliament should legislate for an independent specialist body with responsibility for finding evaders and avoiders of tax and with power to recover tax due. This clearly demonstrates that people in Scotland share the pecuniary values for which Scotland is well known internationally. However, can the Minister advise if the contributors were aware that it is Westminster that has set and perpetuated the regulatory environment where, regrettably, tax can be avoided in this way and that this kind of initiative can only apply to the small percentage of tax that the Scottish Parliament controls?
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and thank the member for the question. The Scottish Government believes that everyone should pay a fair share of tax and support strong measures to tackle tax avoidance and evasion. Wherever we have the power to do so, this principle sits at the heart of our taxpaying policy making. And that's why the Scottish Government principle of good tax policy making includes enforcement. On the member's question about getting feedback, we have been in touch with the convener and a network of members of the Assembly to let them know about the response, and I hope to meet members myself in the near future.
Donald Cameron, to be followed by Evelyn Tweed.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The final report details the cost of the Citizens' Assembly to date. But can I ask the Minister this? What is the budget of upcoming assemblies, and how much does the Scottish Government plan to spend on them throughout the term of this Parliament?
Minister.
Thank the Member for that question as well, Presiding Officer. I believe that when we're looking at this, what I've already set out in my speech was how much would it cost us not to engage with the people of Scotland in a process like this? For me, that's the most important point. But I've already established a participatory democracy working group, which brings together experts from Scotland, UK and international organisations to make recommendations on how we can make participation routine and effective. And bear in mind that we already have these people in force, and the original set-up costs that we had beforehand were because we were setting up this new process. As time moves on, I believe that we'll have a situation where that will be a lot easier for us to work with. The working group will make its recommendations for governance for future Citizens' Assembly and questions setting out from these assemblies. So decisions about the next Citizens' Assemblies will be made after the group has reported to ourselves. And I would say the most important thing for me in this whole process is that we need to encourage this, to continue this, and ensure that it's actually more important that we do engage with the people of Scotland and make sure that we can continue down this route.
Evelyn Tweed to be followed by Sarah Boyack.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Citizens' Assembly recommends that in order to overcome the challenges of poverty, the Scottish Government and Parliament should raise the minimum wage for young people aged 16 to 24 to a national living wage. To ask the Minister what work is currently being undertaken with the UK Government to ensure the Scottish Government have the powers to raise the minimum wage for young people.
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding. At present, the national minimum wage, including the national minimum wage for apprentices, is a reserved matter for the UK Government. So the rates that are set out by the UK Government and the Scottish Government has no remit over these rates. We are fully committed to promoting fair work practices throughout Scotland, and will continue to press the UK Government for the full set of powers around employment law to allow us to fully deliver our fair work ambitions. The Scottish Government has encouraged the abolition of the apprentice rate and a move towards the real living wage of £9.50 per hour for all workers, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Sarah Boyack, to be followed by Rona Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Minister, there are excellent suggestions from the Citizens' Assembly on young people, on participation, apprenticeship pay and housing. How does the Minister envisage the newly announced Youth Citizens' Assembly working with the Scottish Youth Parliament? And having highlighted that apprenticeships are vital for young people, can you say how you're going to use Scottish Government powers of procurement and contracting to ensure apprentices are paid the fair wage? And could you answer Neil Bibby's question about the Scottish Government's date for introducing private rent controls? Thank you.
Minister.
With regards to the first question with how we would engage with other youth organisations, I would assume that they would actually, we would make sure that there would be engagement throughout the level so that we got that ensurement. With regards to how the youth actual assembly would work, I think it's just a case of we need to ensure that we listen to the young people of Scotland to ensure that they will be the ones that will be delivering, living with many of the decisions that we make here in the future. And with regards to the rent control stuff, I could possibly get to Mr Bibby and to Ms Boyack at a later date as well.
Rona Mackay to be followed by Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can the Minister further expand on how the recommendations in the report relate to the work that the Scottish Government is already undertaking to reduce poverty?
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Members will appreciate that there are a complex range of issues that lead to poverty and inform the policies this Government has in place to address them. In fact, some of the debate within the Citizens' Assembly of Scotland itself shows you the complexity of that. We would say that in order to part of the programme for government, the COVID recovery strategy set out a range of measures we are taking to address these issues and identified by the Assembly, including a strong social security system that treats people with dignity and respect, a national mission to eradicate child poverty, and a new Homeless Together fund of £50 million over this Parliament. The Government welcomes the strong support and recommendations of the Assembly to give help to those in our society who need it most.
Alex Cole-Hamilton to be followed by Gillian Mackay.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Can I also warmly congratulate and welcome the work of the Citizens' Assembly? I think it's incumbent on all the parties in the Chamber to reflect on the challenge to do politics differently. And I wish the Young People's Assembly that comes out of this well. I hope that they are given a proper platform to do good work unencumbered by the constitutional skirmishes of this Chamber. Presiding Officer, in Action 33 of the Citizens' Assembly recommended permanent mental health support liaison officers in every school in Scotland. I couldn't see a response to that in the report that the Cabinet Secretary has just introduced. So can I ask the Government whether it plans to do this?
Minister.
I thank the Member for the promotion to Cabinet Secretary. I seem to have gone through the ranks quite quickly here today. One statement and I'm a cab sec already. But basically, just to add to... Many of the recommendations, as I've said during my actual statement, have been taken on board and will be worked through with the Government. A lot of it, in case of the one in particular that you're talking about, will be something that will be looked at along with other recommendations to see how we take it further forward from then. And I'm quite happy to talk with the Member how we take that forward at a later date as well.
Julian Mackay, to be followed by Emma Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I put our thanks on the record to all those who participated in the citizens' assemblies. One of the key weaknesses in participatory democracy is the lack of information about what will happen after the process and unclear assurances about how recommendations will be implemented. This will be particularly important to retain the trust and enthusiasm of young people as we go forward. Can the Minister outline how we can ensure people who participate in assemblies and other processes are clear about how their recommendations will be taken forward?
Minister.
I think Ms Mackay hits the nail on the head on this issue. This is an important part of how we take this forward, because there is no point in us as a government going through this whole process and ensuring that we don't the recommendations made by the individuals on the assemblies don't actually get taken. And I think if I can assure the member by saying that we are committed to have further the assemblies in the future and to continue to use it as a process so that we can develop policy and move forward with knowing that we are actually dealing with the issues that the public want. So any assurance I can give is that this is here to stay and it's not something that's going to go away.
Emma Harper, to be followed by Sharon Dowie.
In addition to citizens' assemblies, can the Minister outline how the Scottish Government is creating space for genuine public involvement in decision making?
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Government is committed to promoting not only citizens' assemblies but other forms of democracy engagement as well, such as citizens' juries, many publics and people's panels. Later this year, an expert group will report with recommendations to ministers on institutionalising inclusive participation democracy across Scotland's democratic processes, including the future governance and questions setting for citizens' assembly. The working group will bring together those that we've already spoken about, of the experts from Scotland, England, the UK and international organisations to propose recommendations of making this routine and effective. They will include identifying methods of governance for delivering credible, trustworthy democratic processes.
Sharon Dowie, to be followed by Colette Stevenson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Last week was Book Week Scotland, so the Scottish Government's additional funding for libraries is welcome, but that funding will have to be spent by the end of the financial year. Even after the funding, 16 libraries still remain closed indefinitely after COVID, with library campaigners branding the move a short-term fix. What thoughts have the Scottish Government had about a long-term solution to the issue of library funding?
Minister.
I'm a bit confused on how much that is actually specific to the issue I'm discussing here. It's something, one of the recommendations, yes, on the fact of the libraries themselves, but at the end of the day, what we have to do is we need to obviously ensure that local governments still have their opportunity to make their decisions locally. And as a former councillor, Presiding Officer, I'm only too well aware of the difficulties and challenges that councils face, particularly this time of year. But our situation that we have with regards to budgets that go to local authority, unfortunately, is in a situation where, as the Scottish Government budget is cut by Westminster, there is obviously challenges created from that. And that's what gives us gives us the problems that we're dealing with in this situation. Of course, some of the recommendations made by the Citizens' Assemblies actually showed that they wanted us to have more powers within this Parliament in order to create that better future that they all want. Maybe that's part of the process, and maybe that's what we should be looking at with the Citizens' Assembly Scotland.
And Colette Stevenson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Does the Minister support the recommendations that this Parliament should have the ability to create a fairer tax system for citizens, raise income from key industries such as tourism, food, drink and energy, and create our own immigration system that works for Scotland? Isn't it time for the Tory government to listen to this constructive democratic report and do the right thing? Otherwise, even more people realise that the best future for Scotland is as an independent country.
Minister.
My answer to that would be a resounding yes to all of the above. It's unfortunate that the current approach the UK government is to constrain and undermine rather than enhance devolution. And, Presiding Officer, this has been a problem that we've actually had in recent time as well. It's a problem that's going to go throughout this institution over the coming months. So the aggressive attitude from the Westminster government towards devolution in general. And it's a conversation I have with my Welsh counterpart on a regular basis as well, as they feel with it. So, yes, on answering that question to the member, I would say yes. Yes, because we live in difficult times, and one of the things, and I think the members should listen to this, is the fact that one of the things that the on part of doing politics different was the fact that they questioned the morality and integrity of many of us in this chamber and other chambers. So therefore we should all take a long hard look at ourselves and see how we should take politics forward and do things differently.
Thank you. That concludes the Ministerial Statement, the Scottish Government response to the report of the Citizens' Assembly of Scotland. The next item of business is a committee announcement, and I call Stuart McMillan, convener of the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee, on an inquiry into the use of made affirmative procedure during the coronavirus pandemic.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Members will know that for the past 20 months, many of the public health measures used to try and protect the people of Scotland from the full impact of the coronavirus have been made using secondary legislation. Many of these measures have been brought into law using the made affirmative procedure. This allows the Scottish Government to bring changes into force immediately. While this chamber needs to approve the changes within 28 days for the regulations to stay in force, the law will often have been altered weeks earlier. Prior to the pandemic, the made affirmative procedure for laying SSIs was relatively rare, really single-digit figures per annum. And since March 2020, we've considered well over 100. The Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee has recognised the need to use the procedure during the pandemic. This has allowed the government to respond quickly to challenges presented by the coronavirus, which has been ever-changing. We've also said that bringing substantial changes into force immediately before any parliamentary scrutiny should only be used when essential and also should not become standard practice, particularly when time would allow the affirmative procedure to be used. The committee is therefore holding a short inquiry to ensure the made affirmative procedure continues to be used appropriately and only when necessary. We hope this work might be of benefit to this chamber as we seek to inform members' consideration of the made affirmative procedure in future legislation. We also want to ensure that there is an appropriate balance between flexibility for the Scottish Government in responding to an emergency situation, whatever that may be, while still ensuring appropriate parliamentary scrutiny and oversight. Our inquiry is due to conclude in early February, and we hope to have the opportunity to highlight our recommendations in the Chamber then. In the meantime, if members or indeed committees wish to provide any comments on their use, we would welcome any input prior to the Christmas recess. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr. McMillan. It is now time to move on to the next item of business. There are no questions to be put as a result of today's business, and that concludes decision time. We'll now move on to members' business, and I would ask members leaving the chamber to do so quietly.